Well, hello, Amy. Good to see you again. Yes, I was just beginning to take inventory. So you can definitely help me with that today. Yes. I just helped my last customer, so if there's no one else in the pharmacy, you can go ahead and lock the front door. Thank you. The bags that we have left over from today, and looks like we only have about 13 on hand, so we'll need at least 30 more for tomorrow. If you could run to the storage room and grab 30 bags, then we'll get of. And then I'll show you around a few places and other tasks that we do after the pharmacy closes. Okay? Another thing that we do every day is file the prescriptions that have come in for the day. As you know, from yesterday, we stamp each prescription with a unique number. This automatically advances the number so we don't have to worry about changing it. Those unique numbers then are also stamped in our prescription record. Right here. And then we list the date, the doctor's name, the patient's name, the price, and the nature of the prescription. So this is going to be priced per prescription. So you'll see, for example, that we have one signature here. Or several prescriptions. So, the important thing to note is that the unique prescription number that we generate here is stamped here. And then if it's a renewal, and not a new prescription, we write in the old prescription number. So, you're either going to see a new number stamped or an old number for renewals. But we do need to make sure we have a number either in this column or this column. As you can see, we have quite a few prescriptions in this book. And if you want to take a closer look at the book later, it will give you some idea of the number of prescriptions we fill in a day, and also the typical number of prescriptions a single patient receives, either new or renewal. And that'll give you a better sense of the flow of the day, and also how many supplies we might need for a given day or week. So that's prescription record. This is a very important book. We are legally required to keep accurate records in case of audit. As I was saying, we've stamped a unique number on each one of these prescriptions, and it matches the number that's in the book. And let me be clear, we have this stamp set on repeat once. What that means is that when you stamp the first time, you'll get a unique number, and when you stamp the second time in the book, you'll get that same unique number, so that the prescription matches the number in the book. So it repeats once. Then the next stamp is a brand new unique number consecutively. And again, it will repeat once, and we stamp in the book. So it is a good practice, after you stamp the prescription in the book, to compare the two numbers, just to be sure that they are matching. Does that make sense? Okay. So, the prescriptions in the book are, by definition, in chronological order. no way to avoid that unless we skip a line. So that's a good thing. But the day's prescriptions in the basket can sometimes get out of order. So we want to make sure that they are in the same order that we have in the book. Now we're going to have multiple prescriptions coming in on the same day. And since we file these at the end of the day, looking at the date probably isn't going to help us. So what we need to do is look at the stamped unique number. This is one of our file boxes. You've probably noticed many of them in the back room. It doesn't take terribly long to fill one of these. And we label the inclusive dates on the front. So you just need to reach in, lift it out. Sometimes you need to squeeze it a little bit. This out of the way. These are nifty little files. All you need to do is squeeze and this will come out. Squeeze this way. These come out and then slide and then you have access to the hooks. So let me point out that the oldest prescriptions are on the bottom. And we add newer prescriptions on the top. But again, after a single set of prescriptions from a given day, the order is by unique prescription number. Since these were all filled today, we're going to be looking at the most recent number is probably going to be on top. So I simply turn them over. Look at this number, and I can begin filing through the holes. The file. Now it can be a little bit cumbersome to turn this over, compare, and then file. what I like to do. Is look at the numbers first, and I'm obviously going to be looking at them in reverse order. So 11537, 11536, 11535. And so on. Okay, this one is out of order. That happens sometimes, especially if we're filling multiple prescriptions for a single patient, and we fill them. We stamp them and fill them, and then as we fill randomly, perhaps, the prescriptions go in the basket. So it's an easy fix. We'll just pull it out for now. Look at the previous number. A skipped number. They're not consecutive. So the correct one is either further in the stack or it might be this one. Let's see. Right. This one goes in right there, and then we're back on track. These are all in reverse order by unique number. And again, before you get started, just turn these over and double check that these two numbers are consecutive. And they are. You can file this way. Or you can gather up two similar sized prescriptions and put them in at the same time, as long as this pile remains turned over, and that way everything will remain consecutive. So it looks like I've got a few more that are the same size, and I can feed them in together. Of course, if at any point you come across one that does not have the two-hole punch, then simply take the puncher and go ahead. But that's why we like to punch these as soon as we receive them. had the same sauce. Not quite. These look similar. Big bunch here. And the last two. Same customer, same doctor. That's all there is to that. Usually just takes a couple of minutes. Then remember to slide this back first. Then you can bring this around, squeeze it, and lock it in. And it's ready to go back in the file box. You would go ahead and take this back, put it on the shelf in the appropriate place, and we'll move on to a few other things. Thanks. Okay, so before you go out here, I conducted an inventory on their items, both our goods, the over-the-counter items, as well as some of our prescription bottles. And I picked up a box of these. Use these bottles for eye drops, ear drops, sometimes as a salve, something to be dropped on the skin and rubbed in, and occasionally we use them as a tincture, where we'll ask the patient to drop one or two or three drops in a glass of water and drink that. So these have a variety of uses. This is the standard size bottle, and it's the one that we use the most. Thank you. just readjust these. Room for the last one. And that should do us for at least tomorrow, if not the next day. These aren't as common as our pills. And then as you can see, we only have two pill bottles left. So I picked up a box of these from the back room as well. These are stackable, of course. One final thing to note. These are four compounded drugs. Anything that comes in a powdered form that is not made commercially. Some pharmacists are able to compound drugs and they have the equipment to make tablets. We don't have that equipment yet. So we use powder paper. These are glassing. And we're able to use the pharmacy fold in order to dispense any compounded powders. To a neat little packet. It involves four folds, but it's essentially thirds and then thirds again. And it's kind of like a little envelope and it fits in these boxes. These are becoming less common as more and more pharmaceutical companies are expanding their offerings, particularly different dosages of the same drug. So if we carry 250 milligrams of a particular drug, and the physician prescribes 100 milligrams or 200 milligrams, we can't fill that prescription using the drugs provided by the companies. So we will use our mortar and pestle and our scale and grind some of those tablets, measure them out into these packets, and then the patient can empty a packet into a glass of water and stir, unless it's something that is not water soluble. These are our standard cough medicine bottles. And it makes compounding the cough medicine much easier because of the measurements built into the bottle. It's very helpful. We use cherry and grape syrup. And I always ask the customer what flavor is preferred. And then again, we use our equipment to add the correct dose of medication to the syrup. I think that's all related to inventory today. I'll introduce you to different aspects of inventory, sending in new orders for inventory, and also sending in orders for drug supplies. So these would be the actual tablets or capsules that the drug manufacturers make, or it would be the raw ingredients, if you will, for compounding drugs. And these all come in the form of a salt. And that stabilizes whatever drug it might be. So you'll see that in many of our powder-based drugs, such as codeine phosphate. And then we also have liquid drugs that we order and use them in our cough medicines in other tinctures, salves, eye drops, ear drops. Most of these are acids. So we work with salts and acids. And as you know from your studies, this is very important to understand the interactions between acids and bases. The salts can neutralize those things and make them more stable. Okay. I think our hour is just about up. Do you have any questions for me today? Well, I look forward to seeing you tomorrow, Amy. I understand that you'll be here before the pharmacy closes. So you'll get an opportunity then to begin to interact with our patients and to receive prescriptions, stamp them, stamp our prescription record, file the prescriptions, obtain patient signatures, things like that. We won't have you actually filling prescriptions until toward the end of the academic year, after you've passed the semester's courses. And then you'll really have an opportunity to have a hands-on experience. Can make, I think, it much easier for you to decide whether you want to go into pharmacy practice or pharmaceutical research. Okay. I'll be right behind you. I'll walk up behind you. Very good. See you tomorrow.